उंगली दे तो पोछा नहीं पकड़ना चाहिए. द थिंग इज दैट इफ समवन गिव्स द फिंगर शुड नॉट कैच दैट. देयर रूल्स एंड रेगुलेशन ना देयर. देयर आर एटलीस्ट 15 पीपल स्टैंडिंग इन द क्यू देयर एंड वन क्वेश्चन. यू कैन हैव आस्क्ड ऑल द थ्री क्वेश्चंस टुगेदर व्हाइल गिविंग अ टॉक. इफ यू इंटरप्ट इन बिटवीन दिस गोज अगेन द रूल्स एंड रेगुलेशन. एंड अ मुस्लिम इज सपोज टू फॉलो द रूल्स एंड रेगुलेशन इफ यू आर अ मुस्लिम. सो यू शुड आस्क टुगेदर इफ इट. यस यू शुड आस्क टुगेदर. अदरवाइज यू शुड आस्क वन क्वेश्चन, गो बिहाइंड द क्यू एंड देन आस्क. So you should wait for 15 people to finish and then you can ask. Otherwise, it becomes a dialogue. Not that I cannot answer. Regarding your last part, because the elderly person I'm answering, were we able to convert anyone? We don't convert anyone. Allah gives hidayah. We cannot convert anyone. Allah says in the Quran, in Surah Yashia, chapter number 88, verse number 21, فَذَكْرِنَّ مَنْ تَمُذَكِّرِ. Our job is to deliver the message. It's Allah who gives hidayah. And alhamdulillah, Allah has given hidayah to thousands of Hindus, mashallah, through the IRF. We have been made the Zariya. And if you see our videotapes, mashallah, I've given a talk on similarities between Hinduism and Islam. And mashallah, when we have in Bombay, we only allow non-Muslims to ask questions. Nowadays, Muslims only listen. Because Muslims are our people, they are not our guests. The non-Muslims are our guests. So mashallah, there are so many non-Muslims queuing up that even though we give 2 to 3 hours for question and answer session, we can't complete all the questions. And mashallah, many of them accept Islam on stage. And I was just there yesterday in Birmingham. There was a Muslim who told me that there's a Hindu in Leicester who's so much impressed with the talk that he wants me to come to Leicester. He wants to call all the Hindus of that area. He will finance everything. He wants to keep my talk, similarities between Hinduism and Islam. And inshallah, Allah may give him that also very shortly. So the thing is that we have to convey the message. Allah gives hidayah, but we should not be afraid. We should be on lines of Quran and Sunnah and deliver a message. Hope that answers the question.
Maybe we have the next question from the little sister standing over there.
Sister asked a very good question. That if someone does very bad, what is the punishment recommended by Allah in the Quran? Depending upon the sin done, we have to realize that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has got various ways of guiding the person. One of them, as you mentioned, is that if someone does a sin, then there is a punishment for that. On the other hand, that if you don't do that sin, then there's a reward for you. So one of the aspects is, if you don't do this, if you don't drink alcohol, there's a reward for you. If you don't do zina, there's a reward for you. And the reward will be here, also in the akhirah. But the point to be noted, depending upon the sin, is the punishment given. But Allah says in the Quran, in Surah Nisa, chapter number 4, verse number 48, and Surah Nisa, chapter number 4, verse number 116, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, if He pleases, He may forgive any sin, but the sin of shirk, He will never forgive. Shirk, associating partners with God, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will never forgive. Any other sin, if He pleases, He may forgive. So we as Muslims, what we should do, that if we see someone doing sin, our beloved Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, that if you see anything wrong, if you can stop it with the hand, stop it with the hand. If you cannot stop it with the hand, then stop it with the tongue. If you can't stop it with the tongue, the least you can do is curse in your heart, and then you will be the lowest level of mu'min, believer. And Allah says that whenever we see something wrong, Allah says in Surah Al-Imran chapter 3 verse 110, تَأْمِرُونَ بِالْمَعْرُوفِ وَتَنْهَوْنَ عَنِ الْمُنْكَرِ, that enjoin what is good and forbid what is wrong and believe in Allah. So if we as Muslims see someone committing a sin, we have to da'wah and islah with that person and tell that person it's a sin, he should not do it, and try and convince him with Quran and Sunnah and with reason and logic. Hope that answers the question.
I would again like to request the non-Muslim brothers and sisters sitting in the audience to please come up to the mic and clarify your doubts and whatever misconception you have about Islam. This is your opportunity. So please, please, please come to the mic and ask questions. And again, the volunteers standing near the mics, I would again request them to please check up the queue. If there are any non-Muslim standing in the queue, bring them forward so that they get the first chance to ask the question. May we have the next question from the brothers standing over there? Yeah.
Assalamu alaikum. Chairman Brother Naik, I'll explain who I am, but first, thank you very much for your talk, and just to let you know that you and Ahmadid are always in my prayers. I'll always thank God for you. And when it comes to public speaking, I always try to emulate you and Ahmadid, and it has helped with the dawah. My name is Hassan. I'm a medical representative for a pharmaceutical company. I'm also involved in the political process. I stood for Parliament last year, and inshallah, I plan to go further in my career. My question is relating to educating extremists and extremist youth. There is one organization headed by a well-known scholar who branded myself as a kafir and other Muslims who got involved in politics as kafirs. They use a Quranic verse which says that if anyone legislates other than Allah, then he becomes a kafir. They use these Quranic verses. They also glorify the 9/11 attacks. The question to you, Dr. Naik, is how do we educate these extremists who claim to follow the Quran and Sunnah?
The brother asked the question that there is an extremist and the head of an organization who has labeled him kafir, and they even glorify the bombing, a suicide bombing, even 9/11. So how do we educate these extremists? See, if you're talking about Muslim extremists, then brother, I call myself a Muslim extremist. I'm extremely kind, I'm extremely honest, I'm extremely just, I'm extremely merciful. What's wrong in being extremely kind? Quran says, be extremely honest. I can't be partly honest. So I'm an extremist Muslim. We don't have to go with the label the Western media puts. When they ask me, I say, yes, I'm an extremist. Extremely honest, extremely kind, extremely just, extremely merciful, extremely kind. What's wrong? And no Muslim can tell me that being extremely honest is wrong. The other people are partly honest, partly just. Jab fayda hota hai just, then you're not a good Muslim. You're not a practicing Muslim. So what the media gives labels on us, we get apologetic. I'm not a fundamentalist. I'm not an extremist. So I'm an extremist. What you may be talking is about fanatics. The difference between a fanatic and an extremist. Now, I don't know who you're talking about, whether X, Y, Z. So my answer may be applicable to that person, may not be. But our beloved Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said that if any Muslim calls any other Muslim a kafir, then that comes back to him. That means he becomes a kafir. Who said a beloved Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam? So if you are a Muslim, and if someone calls you a kafir, the person calling you becomes a kafir according to the hadith of Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. Unless you have done an act of kufr, which he can really prove it, etc. Otherwise, the kufr comes back to him. Coming to the question, that how can we educate those people who glorify these attacks? 9/11, London bombing, etc. Allah says in the Quran in Surah Maida, chapter number 5, verse number 32, if anyone kills any other human being, unless it be for murder or for creating mischief in the land, if any person, Muslim or non-Muslim, kills any other human being, Muslim or non-Muslim, unless it be for murder or for creating mischief in the land, it is as though he has killed the whole of humanity. And if anyone saves any other human being, it is as though he has saved the whole of nation. So killing any innocent human being is haram. It's prohibited. We know that in 9/11, in the bombing of the New York Twin Towers, more than 3,000 innocent people were killed. In London bombing, more than 50 people were killed last year. Just last month in Bombay, 11th of July, 2006, more than 200 people were killed. Killing innocent people is haram. Anyone having even little bit knowledge of Islam cannot condone. These acts should be condemned. It's haram in Islam. But, there are many Muslims who have said this, especially in England and USA, I've heard in front page. But, why are you putting a full stop there? We also have to condemn the thousands of people who have been killed in Afghanistan, the thousands of people who have been killed in Iraq, the thousands of people who have killed in Bosnia, in Gujarat.